वरधरं विष्णुं शशिवर्णं चतुर्भुजं प्रसन्नवदनं ध्यायेत् सर्वविघ्नोपशान्तये. आई विल नाउ रिसाइट वन श्लोक फॉर पतंजलि. प्लीज रिपीट.
योगेन चित्तस्य पदेन वाचां मलं शरीरस्य तु वैद्यकेन योपाकरोत् तं प्रवरं मुनीनां पतञ्जलिं
प्राञ्जलिरानतोऽस्मि. राइट. वेलकम टू दि स्टडी ऑफ पतंजलि योग सूत्रस. We had an introductory class a few days ago, and in that introductory class, I just told you, just to recapitulate a few points which I covered in the introductory class, I told how this yoga is one of the six systems of what are called the Astika Darshanas. Astika means those which accept the authority of the Vedas. So yoga darshana means a school of thought, school of philosophy. Yoga Darshana is one of the Astika Darshanas. And I also told that Sankhya and Yoga, I also mentioned the name called Sankhya. Sankhya and Yoga, they are called the twin or rather sister philosophies, because they share, the metaphysics is same. Sankhya tells about the metaphysical aspect, and Yoga tells how to practice it, how to experience it. Yoga tells about how exactly that what was told in the Sankhya can be experienced. For example, Sankhya says that there are two entities called Prakriti and Purusha. Prakriti means rough matter. And Purusha is what we can call consciousness. And Prakriti Purusha Viveka. Viveka means differentiation between the Prakriti and Purusha. That is what is the goal. That is ultimately what gives you happiness. Basically, the quest is for what? The quest is only for happiness. And that happiness is not by external objects and all that. It is by understanding human nature. It is by resolving our own weaknesses and all our unnecessary chitta vrittis and whatnot. So by that, we have to achieve happiness. And that can be achieved only when we realize what is the ultimate reality. And ultimate reality, according to Sankhya, is that there are two entities called matter and also consciousness. And that consciousness is your real nature. You are not this body-mind complex. Even the mind is something which is called jada, or rather inactive. So that is what is the philosophy, which is also shared by Yoga Sutra. And this yoga tells about how we have to practice. We have to consciously do some practices so that we purify our mind. Basically, the idea is to purify the mind. The conscious practices, they purify the mind, they remove unnecessary samskaras. In Vedanta also, that purification of mind by removing unnecessary samskaras is very, very important. I am using one word called samskara. I think I did not use this word in the introductory class. So samskara, again, I have to explain. Samskara is something like, suppose I have an interaction with somebody today, and that interaction leaves some sort of impression in my mind. Then again, after a few days, I again meet that person. Then again, when I speak to him, then, whatever impression was there in my mind, it comes to the surface, and that forms the basis for my further interaction. And after further interaction, some more impressions are there in the mind. Oh, this man is a good person. Oh, he is like this. He is like that. So like that, every interaction, or suppose I eat some nice dish somewhere. So that particular dish, it has created an impression in the mind. So that impression is there, which is there in my mind. So in fact, it is something like a law of physics only. When two bodies interact, what is called forensic science. They say that when two bodies interact, there is always the traces of one on the other. So that is the basic principle in the forensic science also. So like that, when there is an interaction with any external thing, there is an impression in the mind. And those impressions which are lodged in the mind, they are called the samskaras. And sometimes the samskaras are so strong that it is very, very difficult to eradicate them. One important samskara is that notion of I am this, I am this, I am so and so. That is our basic samskara. So such things, and also raga dvesha, that is likes and dislikes, love, hate, attachment, all these things, they are our they are based on our samskaras or the so called impressions, the subconscious impressions. Actually, subconscious is something which is not used in the word yoga, but suddenly I use that word. What can be called the indelible impressions which are there in the bottom of our mind. We can also use that word subconscious, no harm. So such impressions, they become the obstacles in our inquiry into the nature of truth. So such obstacles have to be removed. So that is the basic idea in yoga. So yoga is the practice, whereas metaphysical aspect or theoretical aspect is the Sankhya. So that is what I told yesterday in the introductory class. And I also told that the whole text is the general structure of the text I explained. That is, it is divided into four chapters. And one is the sadhana pada, sadhana and the samadhi pada. The first thing defines about various types of samadhis. The second tells about how to practice, how to achieve. The third chapter tells about certain vibhuti, or rather supernatural powers which a person is said to acquire when the yoga is practiced properly. And final chapter, the kaivalya pada, it goes into some little bit of metaphysical discussion. Refutation of some of the thoughts of the Buddhists. So it discusses like that. And finally, it also talks about what is called Kaivalyam, what is called the liberation. So this is the general structure of the text. And in the introductory class, there were a couple of questions. One question was about what is the basic text which you recommend. So anybody who comes to this Yoga Sutra class is usually a mature person. So usually not a small kid, somebody who is already an expert in some other field, who is already a mature person, only he or she comes to this particular class. So for those people, the other day I mentioned that Edwin Bryant's book, it is not only for a serious scholar, it is also useful for a beginner also. And the other day I could not show that book, it was not readily with me. So this is the book, Edwin Bryant. The Yoga Sutras of Patanjali by Edwin Bryant. He is said to be a professor in the Rutgers University. So I recommend that you get this book. It is available on the Amazon also. And there was another question about Hariharananda Aranya. There is one commentator called Hariharananda Aranya. Somebody asked, what about Hariharananda Aranya commentary? I had not read at that time, but later I also saw that in the same KYM Yoga Vaisharadi. I told about this website called KYM Yoga Vaisharadi, which is actually a wonderful website. Actually, I'm actually copying the text, showing the text from that only. So the KYM, I saw that Hariharananda Aranya, a long name, Harihara Ananda Aranya. So that gentleman, he is actually a recent person. He is a person from the 20th century only. Right, of course, he is not there now. He lived right up to 1949 or something like that. That information I got from this book only. So that Hariharananda is a really good commentary. Somebody can follow it. It is also in Sanskrit. And anybody who can follow Sanskrit, you kindly read it. It is a really good commentary explaining almost every word of Vyasavakshya. In fact, after reading that, I thought it was really good. So I will also see that in addition to Vijnana Bhikshu's Yoga Vartikam and Tattva Vaisharadi of Vachaspati Mishra, all those texts are available in that website called KYM Yoga Vaisharadi. And one Hindi book which I showed, it covered only two commentaries, that is Tattva Vaisharadi and Yoga Vartikam. But the KYM, that website, it has got more than a dozen commentaries. And some of them are very clear. And actually, there is one more commentary, Narayana Tirtha, one gentleman called Narayana Tirtha. He has written a commentary called Sutrartha Chandrika. That is explaining each and every word of the sutra. That is also important, including the grammar. It's a nice explanation. So people can also see that. So now I think we will start the text. Today we will start with this, the first sutra of Patanjali. Let us see, I will share the text. Yeah, this is the text. Atha Yoga Anushasanam. So that is the first sutra. Atha Yoga Anushasanam. There are three words in this. Atha Yoga Anushasanam. And in our tradition, the word Atha is said to be a very, very auspicious word. Atha, even Brahma Sutras, they start with the letter Atha to Brahma Jignyasa, Atha Atha Brahma Jignyasa. And Purva Mimamsa Sutras, they start with the letter Atha to Dharma Jignyasa. So like that, commencement of any subject, any spiritual, something relating to spiritual, say this metaphysics or something like that. So that starts with the word Atha. Atha is said to be Mangalika, auspicious, Mangalika Artha. And here, of course, it is used just to indicate the commencement of the text. Atha is just used to indicate the commencement. Yoga Anushasanam. Yoga, we have some vague idea about yoga now, or roughly a rough idea, let us say. Yoga, I told you, here, with respect to Patanjali's Yoga Sutra, we derive that word yoga from the root yuja samadhav. Yuja samadhav means that is concentrating the mind, focusing the mind on a particular object. That is meditating, contemplating on a particular thing. That is called yoga. And anushasana. And here yogasya anushasana is one meaning. That is anushasana. I will also explain that word anushasana. What is the word shasana? Shasana sabha, we say. Shasana means administration, giving some orders, giving some instructions. Shasti, shas dhatu, the root shas. Shas means to order, to direct. Shasana means direction. Yogasya anushasanam. Shasanam. Anushasanam. In Mahabharata, you have got a parvam called Anushasana Parvam. What is that Anushasana? Anushasana usually is translated as administration, governance. So Anushasanam is here, it means that there is already somebody who has told. Anu means after. Anu is an upasarga. Anu is a sattva, is a upasarga means a prefix. Anushasanam. It is already there. And I am repeating it. It is already there. It is not as though I am the founder. I am not the starter. I am not the founder or starter of this. There is already there. There is a long tradition of this yoga. And that tradition, I am continuing. So that is the meaning of Anushasana. And in our tradition, it is also, we have to see that people do not claim to be the originators or founders of any particular tradition. And we have a tendency to say, oh, everything started with that Brahma, creator Brahma. Whether you believe it or not, okay, we say that yes, it is started from Brahma. Means it is there in the nature of a human being. When we say it is originating from Brahma, our creator, okay, we can even take a figurative meaning that it is there in the very human nature. So many people have thought in the same manner. Many people, in fact, I was telling you that there are 20 Upanishads which are exclusively talking about yoga, Yoga Upanishads. And even in the other Upanishads, there is occasional mention of yoga. For example, Kathopanishad, very, very clear mention. Yache, Dvang, Manasi, Prajna, so that particular mantra. So like that, there is a mention of yoga in other Upanishads. And 20 Upanishads are exclusively Yoga Kundal Upanishad, Nada Bindu Upanishad, Amrita Bindu Upanishad, Yoga Shikha Upanishad. Like that, there are several Upanishads which are exclusively dealing with yoga. So Patanjali rightly says, I am not the founder. I am only continuing the tradition. But the greatness of Patanjali is all other statements about yoga, they are in a rather random manner. In a rather random way, even in the Yoga Upanishads, either they are oriented to a particular god, maybe Shiva or Vishnu, something, or Shakti, something like that, or they are not so well compiled, so well systematically compiled. So the greatness of Patanjali is that he has compiled them in a very, very, in a very systematic manner, so that we can, it is almost a scientific presentation, we can say, a very, very, very methodical scientific presentation of the yoga principles, which are there in so many books. So let us see this word, Atha Yoga Anushasanam. Yogasya Anushasanam is one meaning. And there is one commentator, I was telling you, there one gentleman called Narayana Tirtha, who has written Sutrartha Chandrika, who also mentions Sutrartha. So he says, Yoganam Anushasanam, he takes the plural. not only one yoga. He is telling about several yogas, so we can also use that word in a plural sense. Yogasya anushasanam, we can say yoganam anushasanam, because that particular samasa, yoga anushasanam, is a samasa that can be interpreted in both ways. So there is nothing wrong. Yogasya, I am telling you the yoga, or I am telling you the yogas, both way. Then atha, now let us see the commentary. Atha ityayam adhikarartha. Please read, will you read it?
Yes.
Atha ityayam adhikarartha.
Atha ityayam adhikarartha.
Atha ityayam, ityayam shabdaha. Atha means atha, that particular word called atha is adhikarartha. Adhikara means the commencement. It is indicating the commencement of a particular text. Adhikarartha means it is just indicating that a particular shastra is commencing. Next, yoga samadhi.
Yoga.
Or without, I'll myself read and go ahead. Yoga samadhi. So yoga, what is the meaning of yoga? He is saying the meaning of yoga is samadhi. And this samadhi, of course, in popular language, it has got several meanings. Samadhi means even a grave is called samadhi. Suppose you go to a graveyard and you see so many graves, those graves there. So a grave also is called a samadhi. It's not like that. Samadhi, the etymological meaning is samyak adhiyate manaha asmin niti samadhihi. In fact, that's why I was telling about that vritti, that is... this gentleman, Vijnana Bhikshu Yoga Vartika, and that Yoga Vartika, he defines every word. So samadhi is that particular state in which the mind is very well concentrated on a particular object. So that is what is samadhi. Yuja samadhav is also same. Samadhi is samyak adhiyate. Sam plus adhi. Samadhi. Sam plus adhi is samadhi. Sam means very well. Adhi means adhiyate. Very well placed. What are you placing? You are placing your mind on a particular object. That is very well placed. So that is samyak adhiyate manaha iti samadhihi. So yoga samadhihi. And the next line says, this particular tendency, this particular ability to concentrate on a thing, it is possible on anything. On anything and everything you can focus. On anything and everything you can focus and concentrate and meditate. Meditation, of course, from a spiritual point of view is different. Contemplate, you can think about it, you can deliberate on that. That is what scientists do. They take a particular thing, they may take a flower, or they may take an animal, they may try to examine what is the composition, etc. So that is, the ability to concentrate, it can be applied anywhere. So that is what he is saying in the next line. Sacha sarvabhaumas chittasya dharmaha. Sacha, sa means it is referring to that yoga. Yoga samadhihi. Saha, saha means that. Saha, here of course, visarga, we have to understand. Sacha is saha cha. Saha means that. That particular ability to concentrate, to have that samadhi, to achieve samadhi, is something. It is sarvabhaumaha, chittasya dharmaha. Let us see what is this chittasya dharmaha. It is the property. Dharma means property. It is the property of the chittam. What is this chittam? Chittam again is a new word for somebody who is totally new to our tradition. Chittam is again a new word. For a student of Vedanta, it is an old word. But chittam, what does it mean? What does it mean? So in our tradition, we examine the antahkarana of the mind at four levels. We notice that there are four levels in the mind. That is when I look at an object. So there is an object in front of me, I just look at it. And in fact, my mind is taking that shape. And the mind, the sense organ, it is transmitting that signal to my mind. And my mind is not yet very clear as to what it is. My mind is just recording it. That recording faculty of the mind, I just look at, I think I have not yet recorded, I have not yet analyzed, I have not yet reacted to that. I have not yet formulated any opinion on that. So that is something which is, that is the level of manaha. Then buddhi. Buddhi means the analytical aspect. Nishchayatmika buddhihi, there is a definition for that. Sankalpa vikalpatmakam manaha. Nishchayatmika buddhihi means that is okay, yeah, this is a pen, this is very good, this is a good, nice highlighter, etc., etc. Okay, I like it, etc. I like it, I don't like it. So nischayatmika, I form an opinion on that. So that opinion is formed on the basis of some little bit of analysis. So that analytical aspect of the mind is called buddhi. So the first level is mind, merely recording. Buddhi is something, this is analytical aspect. Then ahankara. Ahankara does not mean arrogance. In normal kind, colloquial language, where we say, oh, that man is an ahankari. Ahankari means we say, oh, he is such an arrogant person. So here in Vedanta or in Shastra, any Shastra, ahankara does not mean in any Shastra, whether it is Sankhya, whether it is Yoga, or whether it is Nyaya, Vaisheshika, etc. Ahankara means the I sense. The sense that I, the most primary notion which we have is that I exist. So that is the most primary thing. So that is I, that I notion is one thing. Suppose I see something, yes, I know it. Yeah, it becomes my knowledge. So that I notion is one. Then chittam comes later. Chittam is that faculty where I recall after some time. This pen is not in front of me, but after some time I do recall. There I saw some pen, a nice pen. So that is something, the recalling faculty is called the mind, because those ideas, they are there lodged in the mind. And chitta is also related to the samskaras. I was telling you the word samskara. Samskaras are those indelible impressions which are formed or which are caused by various interactions in our life, in our lives. So right from childhood, we have so many innumerable interactions. And all those innumerable interactions, they create so many innumerable impressions in our mind, So then what happens, a person is actually what his mind is. A person is what his impressions are, what his all those packed up, or all those lodged impressions are. So that is what a person is. Mind is full of so many things. Love. In fact, that Upanishadic line is there. That long line which says, Agrihi dhihi tyetas sarvam manayeva, there is a long line. So all those things, all these impressions belong of so many categories, and these impressions belong to so many categories. There are impressions relating to likes, there are impressions relating to fears, there are impressions relating to something else. So like that, all these things, they constitute the human being. So this chittam is that. Chittam is that ability to recall things and then which again from analyze, recalling and of course recalling and again and then buddhi also joins. So that is where, that is how we see that, if you recall that Shankaracharya's line, Mano buddhi ahankara chittani naham. There is one shloka there. Manaha buddhi chittam ahankara. Mano buddhi ahankara chittani naham. I am not that. I am not manas. I am not buddhi. I am not ahankara. I am not chittam. That's Siddhananda Rupa Shivoham Shivoham. Those lines are there, isn't it? So this chitta is that. Chittasya dharma means it is the property of the mind. What is the property of the mind? Yoga or samadhi is chitta dharma. Chitta dharma means it is the product, it is the property of the mind. And what is that? Again, there is a qualification for that. Sarvabhaumaha chittasya dharma. Sarvabhauma means in all bhumis. Sarva means all. Sarva bhumi. Sarvasu bhumishu. That means bhumi means a particular plane. Whatever plane, you know, whatever thinking plane you are. Of course, chitta, that plane he is going to describe later. In the very next sentence, he is going to describe what are those planes, what are those levels. Mind is in different states. Mind is not always in one particular state. Mind is in so many different states. And those different states are due to the fact that every human being is a mix of what are called the three gunas. What is called the sattva guna, so rajo guna and tamo guna. Not only the human being, everything in the universe is a mix of these three gunas, sattva, rajas and tamo guna. Everything in the universe. In fact, that Bhagavad Gita 14th adhyaya, I think the last shloka it says, natadasti prithivyam yat divi deveshu va punaha, that shloka says, there is nothing in the entire creation which is not a mixture of these three gunas. So that is what the shloka says. So not only we, even an ant, a mosquito, or even the vegetables we eat, all the things, everything we see is a mix of sattva, rajas and tamo guna. So that is why we say in Ayurveda people say, no, you should not eat it. It causes some reaction in the sense, it produces certain tendencies in you. It doesn't produce certain good tendencies. Such and such food is called sattvika ahara. In fact, in Gita, in fact, the chapters 14 and 17, they can be read along with this Yoga Darshana also. People who are seriously, who want to know what exactly are the gunas, the description of the gunas, how they manifest in the human being, they are very well described in the Bhagavad Gita, particularly chapters 14 and 17. Even if we do not read the entire Bhagavad Gita, even if we read chapters 14 and 17, that gives a very clear picture of the human behavior, basically a description of human behavior there. Then, Sarva Bhaumaha means in all the planes, Sarvasu Bhumishu, that is the ability to concentrate or contemplate on a thing, it pervades, it extends to all fields, it extends to all levels of mind, all planes of mind. And what are those planes of mind? So he is describing in the very next line, Kshiptam Moodham Vikshiptam Ekagram Niruddham Iti Chitta Bhumayaha. So if I want to read the entire thing, Kshiptam Moodham Vikshiptam Ekagram Niruddham Iti Chitta Bhumayaha. So Kshiptam, Kshiptam means that which is tossed about. It is not tossed about, T-O-S-S-E-D, tossed about. That is, Kshipa, the Dhatu. Dhatu means the root. Yeah, about this Chittasya Dharmaha. Yeah, one more point here is, when he says Yoga, Samadhi, Chitta Dharma, it is the property of the mind, he is also saying that it is not the property of what is called Purusha. There are two words called Prakriti and Purusha in Sankhya and also in Yoga. Purusha is consciousness. Prakriti is the whatever is seen, whatever is creation. So here, Chittasya Dharma means it is the property of the body-mind complex. It is the property of the mind. It is not the property of that Purusha. It is not the property of consciousness. So this is an important point we have to note here. Sarvabhauma Chittasya Dharma. It is a Chitta Dharma and not the Dharma, not the property of consciousness. Because consciousness does not undergo any change. That is something which is accepted both by Vedantis and also by yogis. Now, Kshiptam Moodham Vikshiptam Ekagra. Kshipta. Kshipa means to throw. Kshipa. Kshipati. Saha Prastaram Kshipati means he throws. That's wrong. Kshipati. Kshipani, that word Kshipani means a missile. Kshipta is something which is thrown. So, Kshiptam means something which is thrown about, which is tossed about, which is kicked about, let us say. So, Kshiptam, that is one level. And Moodham. Moodham is another level, that is, I am in a sort of daydreaming. I am doing some daydreaming or something which is in a rather dull state. Mooda, muhu dhatu. The dhatu is muhu. Muhu means not able to perceive the reality. Unable to perceive reality and I am just daydreaming. I am in my own world. So that is mooda. That is wrong perception. Then vikshiptam. V is another upasarga. V plus kshiptam. Vikshiptam. Visheshena. That is, sometimes there is some little bit of concentration. Sometimes it is tossed about. So that is that vikshiptam. Vikshiptam. Then ekagram. Ekagra means, eka means one. Agra means a tip. Agra is some tip. Suppose this is the tip of a pen. It is called agram. Shikharagram. Suppose we say shikharagram. Shikhara is a peak, let us say. Agram means a tip. So, ekagram means one-pointed or so highly focused, vikshiptam ekagram. Ekagram, sometimes the mind is in that state, we are focusing on a particular thing. It may not be something to do with God, it may not be something to do with anything to do with any spiritual practice. A scientist is concentrating, suppose a mathematician is concentrating on a problem. Some other scientist is concentrating or focusing on something else. So, that is called ekagram. Then, niruddham. Except yogi, nobody does niruddham. Except yogi and also Vedanti. Vedanta also, he also wants this. So, this yogi and also Vedanti who practices Sravana Manana Nididhyasana. So, he is also striving for the same. Niruddham is nirodha. Nirodha means a stoppage. Nirodha is not a forcible stoppage here. We have to see that nirodha actually means, one commentator says, nirodha means upashama. Upashama is not forcibly try to stop all chitta vrittis. Because when you just sit, close your eyes and then sit and then watch our ideas, they flow in a stream. and that stream goes on and on. And usually it is unending. So we have to analyze those things. We have to slowly analyze those things and then drive away some unnecessary things and bring some good chitta vrittis. Suppose we bring some sattvika, some good chitta vrittis, then okay, after some time you become focused on a particular thing, maybe something to do with a spiritual practice. So then some little bit of concentration materializes. Till that time, concentration doesn't materialize. So Niruddha is at two levels. He is going to say Niruddha is a total removal of all things and focusing on a particular thing. That also he tells. He is going to say that. So now we are seeing that there are five levels. One is Shiptam, second is Moodham, Vikshiptam third, Ekagram fourth, and Niruddham iti. Chitta Bhumayaha. Bhumi means not our land. Normally Bhumi, what do we mean by Bhumi? Bhumi means land. It is not land. Bhumi means a plane. Any plane of thinking. For example, in Hatha Yoga also they talk about Chitta, what is it? Saptavidha Yoga Bhumika. Saptavidha Yoga Bhumika. Yoga Bhumika means you are in a particular plane. The very idea that, yes, I have to follow this yoga, I have to follow this particular shastra, it is the primary level. So like that, they keep on telling about, describing the seven levels. And even during our Sandhya Vandana, we say, Bhumi Bharakaha, Uttishtandu Bhuta Pishacha, Yete Bhumi Bharakaha. What is that Bhumi Bharakaha? Bhumi does not refer to earth there. Bhumi again means Chitta Bhumi. Chitta Bhumi is the plane, that particular mind, in which all stupid thoughts, unnecessary thoughts which are coming, they are the Pishachas. Pishachaha means Vishunam Adanti Atti. Iti Pishachaha. Vishunam Atti Iti Pishachaha. It actually eats up a human being. My own worries, my own anxieties, they are the Pishachas. So like that, that Sandhyavandana Mantra says, Uttishtantu Bhuta Pishachaha. Bhuta Pishachaha. All the thoughts about the past, all the thoughts, all my anxieties and worries, they are the bhutas and pishachas. Let all the things go away. Let me concentrate on this reality called Brahman. So that is what we do in Sandhya Vandana. So now we see these the five chitta bhumis. And why are these chitta bhumis there? Of course, right now I can briefly say that is because of the manifestation of the three gunas. There are three gunas. This again is a technical word. For a newcomer, it is a technical word. What are these three gunas? The gunas are the properties in the creation. The gunas are what we call, we have seen that there are two entities called Prakriti and Purusha. And in this Prakriti is having three constituents. These three constituents are called Sattva, Rajas and Tamoguna. And these things, as I said, they manifest in all the beings, in all things, sentient and insentient, in all the things, these three gunas are there. So how in the human beings, because we are concerned with the human beings, in human beings, how are the gunas manifesting? This sattva guna is manifesting when you look at a person. Suppose a person is very, very quiet, usually contented, very truthful, and usually oriented to knowledge and very straightforward. So we say that, oh, he's a good man, we say. In a general vague adjective we use is, he's a good man. But in technical language, you have to say sattva guna pradhana. A person who is contented, who doesn't inflict pain, any type of pain on others, ahimsa, krodha, compassion, all these things. So those qualities, these are, and also contentment. He is not very, very ambitious, he is just contented. So these are the qualities which are the result of what is called the sattva guna in a person. Rajoguna. Rajoguna means I want to achieve, I want to do this, I want to do that. And always driving and driving myself and driving others. That is, Gita says, lobha pravrutti rarambhaha. Always pravrutti. Pravrutti means always engaged in action. Always in a new endeavor. Arambha. Then all these things, the quest for things, of course, that is all that is needed. In a manager, it is needed. In a ruler, it is needed. In a manager of a sort of company or something like that, it is needed. It is not something which is needed in a sadhaka. Anyway, lobha, this rajas is, it manifests as, sometimes as greed also. And this rajoguna manifests as, this power also in two ways. That is physical power, physically dominating over others. I want to be the leader. And the other type of power is economic power. I want to acquire more and more and more. So these two ways. And then tamoguna is manifest as some sort of dullness, not thinking in nature, just obeying commands, and sometimes having some foolhardy ideas and sticking on to those ideas. I don't want to change my ideas. And also, in fact, for those ideas, in fact, I don't mind being a fundamentalist and even fight others. So these are the qualities of tamoguna. So sattvaguna, rajoguna, and tamoguna, they manifest in the human beings in this particular fashion. So because of these gunas, and every human being is a combination of these. If you take from 0 to 100 scale, there is no human being who is 100% sattvika. There is no human being who is 100% rajasa or 100% tamasa. Coming to this rajasa tamasa words, sometimes in English we use the expressions rajasik and tamasik. In English, of course, some people do write, but rajasik and tamasik are grammatically incorrect. We have to say sattvaguna. For sattvaguna, the adjectival form is sattvika. For rajas, rajoguna, rajasa is the adjectival form, rajasa, and tamasa. We should not say rajasik and tamasik if you are a student of Sanskrit, but otherwise, okay, many people, they write rajasik and tamasik. So, okay, that is by way of explanation. So this rajo, there is nobody who is 100% tamoguna. There is nobody who is 100% tamasa, 100% rajasa, or 100% sattvika. There is always a mixture. And that is, basing on this only, we find that in the Gita categorizes the human beings depending on the constitution. It is basically something like personality types. Nowadays, modern psychology analyzes people or categorizes people into various types. So it is somewhat like that, whatever categorization was done. Let us not go into that. So this shiptam, moodam, vikshiptam, etc. It is all the result of this shiptam, moodam, vikshiptam, etc. This is the result of the activity of this sattvaguna, rajoguna, samoguna, tamoguna. This shiptam is because of the sattva, this rajoguna. When you are activated by rajoguna, our mind runs after so many things, some new gadgets which have come into the market, or something else, new hotel which has started, or something new which has come. So all my mind is running after all those things I want to acquire and acquire. So my mind is tossed about, I am attracted by so many things. Mooda is dull when my mind is, this tamoguna is active. In every human being, tamoguna is there. Sometimes the tamoguna also gets activated. And vikshiptam, sometimes we try to concentrate, and then we try to do some dhyanam, meditation, etc. And sometimes we do achieve, very often we do achieve this particular state. Ekagra is one state which is achieved with some difficulty. Ekagra is some state which we can achieve with some difficulty. Niruddham is something where total eradication of all thoughts. I have to confess that I have never achieved this state. I have only gone up to this ekagram state. Niruddham is where this total eradication of all, eradication means total absorption. We should not say eradication. Eradication means forcible removal. Absorption, totally they just get laya. That laya is a word in Sanskrit. Laya means they just get resolved. They just get resolved into the prakriti. So all these gunas, they disappear. So niruddham is that particular state. Then let us see. Tatra vikshipte chetasi. विक्षेपोपसर्जनी भूतः समाधिः न योगपक्षे वर्तते तत्र विक्षिप्ते चेतसि. इन दैट दिस व्यास भाष्य वी आर नाउ रीडिंग दिस व्हाट इज कॉल्ड व्यास भाष्य. व्यास, आई टोल्ड यू दैट ही इज नॉट द सेम व्यास हु रोट महाभारत. ही इज सम अदर मच मच लेटर व्यास, बिकॉज व्यास कैन बी एनीबडी. इवन टुडे देयर आर थाउजेंड्स ऑफ व्यासस. इफ यू गो टू नॉर्थ इंडिया, देयर आर थाउजेंड्स ऑफ पीपल हु हैव देयर नेम एज व्यास व्यास. So even here also, many people are there. So vikshipte chetasi. We are now reading this Vyasa Bhashya. Vikshipte chetasi. In that state of vikshepa. Vikshepa, the mind which is there in that vikshepa, state of vikshepa, it is called vikshipta chetasa. That is something, it is occasionally getting some concentration. So Vyasa is not mentioning the first two things, that shiptam and moodam. They don't even deserve consideration. So that is why he is not even mentioning the kshiptam and mudam. One state is where that is something which his mind is just wandering and tossed about. Mudam is something which is deluded, daydreaming. So these two things, Vyasa is not even mentioning them. He is straight away coming to this vikshipta cheta, vikshipta level. and that vikshipta cheta, now he is analyzing whether it can be called a samadhi or not. Vikshipte chetasi, in that mind, in that state of mind, what happens? Vikshepa upasarjani bhutaha, vikshepa plus upasarjani bhutaha becomes vikshepa upasarjani bhutaha. Samadhihi na yoga pakshe vartate. That is, it cannot be categorized as yoga because this vikshepa, this is samadhi, is something which is subordinated by vikshepa. Upasarjani bhutaha means subordinated. It has been rendered secondary. Upasarjanam is secondary. Upasarjanam is second. Upasarjani bhutaha means something which has been subordinated. By what? Vikshepena. Vikshepena. Upasarjani bhutaha. Samadhi. This samadhi, whatever you call this focusing, is something which is subordinated or made secondary, rendered unimportant by this vikshepa. So that is the reason why it cannot be called or categorized as yoga. It cannot be categorized as yoga. Now, what are these remaining things? Remaining things are only two, ekagram and niruddham. This ekagram is, it can be categorized as samadhi. Niruddham can be categorized as samadhi. What is that? So he is coming in the next line. Yastu ekagre chetasi, yastvekagre chetasi. That if you split the word, yaha tu ekagre chetasi, yaha tu ekagre chetasi, sadbhutamartham pradyotayati. So up to this point, you have to put a comma. I could have put a comma also. Maybe next time I'll put some commas also. Ekagre chetasi sadbhutamartham pradyotayati. That is, in that state of concentration, you are focusing on one real object. Sadbhutam. Sadbhutam means something, a real object. And here, all the commentators have said, real object does not mean a pen or something else or some other scientific topic. They have all said, it is something relating to the higher reality. What we call, it may be God, or what is the reality. If you accept God, okay, it is, you can call it God. If you don't accept God, okay, whatever is what you want to see. Ultimately, everybody has to see what is the, some, there should be some reality somewhere. So if not God, we have to identify something else. So what is that? Sadbhutam artham. What is that real thing? Artham pradyotayati. Dyotanam means lightening up, illumining. Pradyotayati means it very well illumines. Pra is an upasarga. The very word dyotayati is good enough. Pradyotayati means very well illumines. Sadbhutam artham pradyotayati. Saha yoga. You see, yastu ekagre chetasi, in that particular ekagra state, where this sadbhutam, one particular reality is highly illumined, then kshinoti cha kleshan. There are so many technical words used in this for very first two, three sutras. That is why I was telling you in the introductory class that you should not be bamboozled. You should not be intimidated by the technical terms in this first two, three sutras. If we are totally bamboozled by them, then we will not continue. So a student of yoga sutras, totally who is new to our tradition, somebody who is in the tradition, he will not feel bad. Somebody who is totally new, he will feel, hey, what is all this? Kshinoti cha kleshan, that which weakens. Kshinoti, kshinam karoti, kshinam, we know the word kshinam. Kshinam means something which is going down. Kshinam karoti cha kleshan, something which is eliminating the kleshas. Klesha means all the obstacles which stand in the path of dhyana, which stand in the path of meditation, which stand in the path of yoga, klesha. And what are these kleshas? He is going to say later, what are these obstacles? Tentatively, let us accept the meaning as an obstacle, something which has to be removed, klesha. Kshinoti cha klesham, that which weakens the kleshas. Then karma bandhanani shlathayati. Karma bandhanani shlathayati means it weakens the bondage of karma. It weakens the bond. Shlathayati. Shlathayati means weakens. Shlatha. Then karma bandhanani, it weakens the bondages of karma. What is this bondage of karma? Again, for a newcomer, I have to explain that we have what is called a karma siddhanta. All the Indian schools, except the Charvaka, all the Indian schools, including Buddha, Bauddha and Jaina, they accept this karma siddhanta. They may not accept the supremacy or authority of the Vedas, Bauddhas and Jainas. They don't accept the authority of the Vedas, but they do accept almost all things which are there in the Veda, Vedic Dharma, that is Karma Siddhanta, Punarjanma, that is basically to account for the good behavior of a person, or rather promote good behavior in society, and also to account for the diversity in human nature. You see, there is so much of diversity. Why is Karma Siddhanta accepted in Indian tradition? Means we see so much of diversity in the nature. Somebody is born rich and somebody is born poor. Somebody is physically fit and very, very healthy, and somebody is not very fit. Somebody is very good looking and all that. Somebody is lame or blind, or somebody is lame, some other deformity. So like that, why should God create like this? Suppose you say that, oh, God has created all these people. Why should God create in such dissimilar manner? So which means God is having some likes and dislikes. God has created somebody with love and somebody with some sort of disregard. Why should he do that? So God, or whatever we call creator, is only a karma phala data. In our siddhanta, in Indian tradition, in all schools of Indian tradition, God or this creator or Ishvara is a karma phala data. Even the Buddhists and these people, they also accept some type of authority. They don't call it God, but there is some mechanism by which their karma phala is attained. Karma phala means the fruit of action. Suppose I do some good karma, I have to get some good result. And I do some bad karma, I will get bad result. And in order to experience or to undergo, or rather have that good result, it may not be possible in one janma. Suppose I do so many karmas all through the day, all through our lives, we do so many karmas. And it will not be possible to have the effect in the very same life. So I have to have one more janma to experience all those things, whether it is good or bad. And sometimes the next janma may be good, sometimes the next janma may be bad. So karma is something which binds. Karma is something when I am destined, or rather when I am forced to get the karma phala. When I am forced to get the karma phala, it means that I am bound by karma. I am doing a karma and I am bound by that karma. I have to necessarily enjoy, or rather I have to get the result of that karma. So that is what is called bandhanam. A good karma also is a bondage. Bad karma also is a bondage. So that is why the teachers say that good karma is like a golden chain. Suppose you have a lot of punyam. That lot of punyam also is like a golden chain. And because of that golden chain, you take birth. Then again, next birth, we do not know what type of actions we do. Then bad karma, again, it is like iron chain. Whether it is an iron chain or a golden chain, it is a chain. So that is why it is karma bandhanaris lethayati. Nirodham abhimukham karoti. Nirodha means that total absorption of ideas. Nirodha is that total removal of ideas. This cannot happen unless we analyze all those thoughts, and then we analyze all our emotions, and all our the entire human nature has to undergo a sort of kayakalpa chikitsa, what they say. It has to undergo a change, and all the bad samskaras in the mind have to be eliminated, and good samskaras have to be brought, and even those good samskaras finally they disappear. So that is what is Nirodha. Nirodha is even those good samskaras disappear. It is somewhat like what Vedanta also says. Vedanta says, akhandakara vritti, that vritti also goes away. Here also the same thing happens. Nirodham abhimukham karoti, sa sampragnyato yoga ityakhyayate. Something is missing here. Sampragnyato yoga iti akhyayate. Akhyayate means it is told. That particular yoga is called sampragnyata. There are two prefixes there. Sam is a prefix, pra is another prefix, gnyata is the root, that is the verb. Gnyata means something which is known. Pragnyata means well known. Sampragnyata means very, very well known. Sampragnyata. So that which is sampragnyata yoga is one in which Your mind is focused on this sadbhutam artham pradyotayati. These are all various clauses in the same sentence. Sadbhutam artham pradyotayati is one portion. Shrinoti cha kleshan is one portion. Karma bandhanani slathayati is one portion. So the sampragnyata yoga is doing all these four things. What it is illumining, that whatever reality which you are thinking about. And it is also weakening these kleshas, obstacles of the mind. Are you able to see the cursor also? Because I am moving the cursor. Then karma bandhanani slathayati. It is also weakening the bondage of karma. then it is also enabling you. Nirodham abhimukham. Abhimukham is moving towards. Abhimukha. Abhi means towards. Abhimukham is moving towards. Nirodham abhimukham karoti means you are moving towards, or rather facilitating that nirodha, that next stage. The next stage is nirodha. Prior to that total nirodha, it is called sampragnyata. So nirodham abhimukham karoti sa sampragnyato yoga iti akhyayate. That sampragnyata yoga is one in which the object of meditation is very well illumined, and it is actually weakening your kleshas. Obstacles are weakened. Karma bandhanani, the bondage of karma is weakened, because you are analyzing, and then because of analysis you are reducing your unnecessary karma. So karma bandhanani slathayati, and again you are moving towards what is called nirodha. Sa sampragnyato yoga ityachak akhyayate. Sacha vitarkanugato vicharanugata anandanugato asmitanugata ityuparishthat nivedayishyamaha. This is again another somewhat like a iron block. So here he is mentioning four words. Sacha, sa means he is referring to that sampragnyata. Sa sampragnyata yoga, that particular sampragnyata yoga is of four types. One is called vitarkanugata. Vitarka is very, I'll tell very very brief meaning here, because we are going to see later. Vitarkanugata is meditating on this sthula objects. Sthula means gross. For example, I do my panchabhuta meditation. If you go to a guided meditation class, sometimes the teachers talk about what is called panchabhuta meditation. You meditate about how your body mind complex is constituted, and how these panchabhutas, prithivyapas, tejo, vayu, akasha, panchabhutas are responsible for this. So I am meditating on the sthula or the gross things, and I am trying to see the reality. That is vitarka. Vichara is about the subtle body. I am meditating on the mind, the sense organs, and again adibhautika level. I am thinking about the what are called the tanmatra, panchabhutas. There again sthula rupa, sushma rupas are also there. I am thinking about the sushma bhutas also. That is pancha tanmatras we say. So I am thinking on that is vicharanugata. Then anandanugata, I am just thinking about all these things are not there. I am concentrating on what is called ananda, bliss, by removing all unnecessary thoughts. Then asmitanugata, when I am this vitarkanugata, vicharanugata, when they proceed as a result of all these things, asmitanugata, the notion of I alone remains. That I, that asmita. Asmita means I. Asmi means I am. In grammar, in Sanskrit, aham asmi means I am. Asmita means that thing, that idea that I am, that I notion remains, and all other things, they disappear. So that is asmitanugata. So this sampragnyata samadhi is four types. We do not know whether there are people who are really practicing all these things, because if we see the modern trends in yoga, nobody talks about vitarka, vichara, etc., etc. In fact, the guided meditation on this panchabhutas, guided meditation on Vedanta classes, I am not sure whether anybody does these things now in yoga classes, yoga schools rather. Anandanugata, asmitanugata iti uparishtat nivedayishyama. Uparishtat means in the later portion of the text. Uparishtat in the later portion of the text. Nivedayishyama. Uparishtat plus nivedayishyama. Uparishtan nivedayishyama. Or I will split these things also. Next time I will also split these things so that somebody who knows some Sanskrit will be able to follow. Uparishtat nivedayishyama. Later I am going to explain. That's what he says. Then sarva vrutti nirodhetu asampragnyata samadhihi. When you resolve all the vruttis, sarva vrutti. Vrutti means, I told you, oh yeah, vrutti, I did not tell. Yeah, only 2 minutes. So vrutti means, that is, when I look at an object, my mind takes the shape of a particular object. And that vishayakara vrutti, it is called. So that means my mind is in that particular shape. My mind undergoes that particular change. So my mind undergoes some modification. This type of change or modification of the mind is called a vrutti. Vartate anaya iti vrutti. My mind is on this. So sarva vrutti nirodhe. When all these vruttis, when all these mental thoughts, thought modes, let us say, all these thought frames, when all these thought frames are removed, that is called asampragnyata. In this sampragnyata, there is a focus, there is an object. In this asampragnyata, there is no object at all. There is total, you remain as pure consciousness. So that is what in the very first sutra, Vyasa has dumped so much of material, and then this again we have to listen maybe second time. Unless you listen to it again, a total newcomer will not be able to grasp. So I request the newcomer, if there's so anybody, some people who are listening for the first time, I request them to listen to this again so that you have to understand the technical words. The next 2-3 sutras are also like this. They are full of terminology, which I will explain slowly. Now, if there are any questions, I am okay.
Can you read out, please? Yeah. Shantanuji is asking, are samskaras different from vasanas?
They are one and the same. Samskara and vasana are one and the same. Samskara again is the same indelible impressions. Vasati iti vasana. Vasati. That which is there, that which stays. Vasana. Samskaras, vasanas, they are one and the same. Yeah. That is the reason why there is a whole chapter called Vasana Kshayam in Jivan Mukti Viveka Vidyaranya. Vidyaranya, sage Vidyaranya, has written a wonderful book called Jivan Mukti Viveka, where a whole chapter is devoted for Vasana Kshayam, for the elimination of all these Vasanas or Samskaras. Yes, please.
That's all, only one question.
Okay, thank you. If there are no questions, thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much.
Hari Om, Tat Sat.